I know the media, Dan Bongino, they're not making as big a deal about this. You know, I was watching Nat Geo for two straight hours, summary of the entire World War II, and how far Hitler got. You know, and the moment when Hitler was partnered with Tojo Japan and Mussolini, so it was fascism, Nazism, and in the beginning, the former Soviet Union and communism, till he makes the trek into Russia, then Stalin switched sides and joins forces with us. But you think how far he got and how dangerous it was. Thinking ahead about denuclearizing the entire peninsula, wow. You know, I thought liberals wanted to imagine a world of peace.
Well, they're not. And you saw Chuck Todd, I think it was this weekend, who said that, well, this is just going to be like a press kind of photo op for Trump, which is the, you know, height of being disingenuous. I mean, Sean, if the North Koreans now, I said this morning on Fox and Friends, if they're about, a 9 on the danger scale out of 10, and Trump can cut that down to a 7 by getting a full accounting of how many weapons they have, you know, by getting our remains back, which is a nice gesture to start, and we can get an idea of even where their technology is, because we don't even have an idea about their capacity for reentry vehicles. It's still an open question now, obviously, which wouldn't affect, like, EMPs or any kind of atmospheric detonation or anything like that. But the fact that he could take it down from, say, a 9 to a 7 would be a success. And the media pretending like this stuff happens overnight is just a misreading of history.
But Dan Hoffman, we're not talking about a 7 here. We're talking about if the president is fully successful. Number one, he has a ton of success. Nobody in the media wants to give him any credit. But if we get a denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, okay, South Korea, North Korea, Japan, Guam, even China, the world is a much safer place. And if you ever got rockets that could reach the continental U.S., we're really all in much more serious danger.
Yeah, Sean, no question about it. That's a laudable goal. And we have achieved a lot so far. Let's remember that there have been no nuclear tests since September 2017, no missile tests since November 2017. As Dan mentioned, we got three hostages back, the remains of our fallen soldiers. Let's also remember, too, that Kim Jong-un has started dismantling the rocket engine site at Sohae, as well as the nuclear test site in Punggye-ri. Those are places where we need to get inspectors. I would highlight, look, let's have realistic expectations. Kim Jong-un is a ruthless dictator, but I think you have to applaud the administration for having taken us as far as we have. We're on the path to arms control before we get to denuclearization.
You know, it may be, in spite of all the economic success, Dan Bongino,
yeah.
You know, here we have something in the Middle East that's unprecedented. You have the Saudis, the Egyptians, the Jordanians, the Israelis, the U.S., the Emirates, and other countries aligning against Iranian hegemony in a partnership, putting Khashoggi aside, which is, you know, unforgivable to me. And I've been the most outspoken person, I think, on public television and radio about the Saudis and the money. I mean, we're talking about deep, profound, historic changes. And add to that, we don't need their oil anymore. We're the number one producer of oil and gas in the world because of Trump.
You know what I think it's been, trying to read this and put the lead out first, I think it's his strategic unpredictability. You know, Sean, we have tried things from the establishment intelligentsia on the foreign policy front the same way for, what, 5 decades now? And candidly, outside of Reagan, yeah, there have been successes. I don't want to be hyperbolic, but we're at the same stalemates in places like North Korea and in the Middle East. I think the fact that Trump has said, you know what, we've tried that, it doesn't work, we're going to do it my way, from an all-business-I-need-deliverables approach, has changed everything because they don't know what he's going to do next. But, you know, I was just thinking about it. I didn't want to undersell his success before. I hope he didn't take it that way, Trump's success with North Korea. Sean, the country is dying. They have no hard currency. Remember, Kim doesn't care if he feeds his people. If they die, that's just a negative externality of his tyranny. But he does care if he can pay off his military. He has no hard currency. Trump was bankrupt, and these sanctions are killing them. So, again, a success that will be completely ignored by these.
Just like it's
in the
killing
media.
Iran.
Iran, too?
Yeah. Dan Hoffman, look, you have traveled the world. You've worked in intelligence all your life. You have this uncanny ability to scare the living daylights out of everybody that works for me.
Thanks, John.
Because you know the capabilities of intelligence. And you're basically saying the minute we all land in a place like Vietnam, everything we have on is hacked. Everything. And that I'm probably being spied on when I take a shower, which is really frightening to me.
Yeah, that's frightening to all of us, Sean, frankly.
Yeah. Thanks, Dan. Welcome to Vietnam.
I learned that skill. Never turn the lights on in the shower.
Now, listen, you know...
Some of us need to see in there, Dan.
The summit is of great interest, obviously, to us and to North Korea, but it's also of great interest to Russia and China. And they have extraordinarily just extensive and sophisticated espionage capability. They are here in full force with cyber capabilities, and they've got human assets on the ground seeking to obtain as much intelligence as they possibly can. You know, it's a chance to get at the North Korean hermit kingdom. As you all mentioned, Kim Jong-un is bringing advisors with him, and I'm sure the Russians are interested in targeting them and the Chinese as well for intelligence.
But on the other hand, you said something that caught my interest. You said they're not interested in it for lurid details. They're more interested in this for, like, for example, they would be more likely to hold on to all of this. And they're more interested in the president. They don't care, even if they were, say, videoing Dan Bongino and you in the shower, they don't care about that. They care about...
Not at the same time. The way that came out was kind of interesting.
Maybe we should just skip the whole shower reference. I don't think that helps right now.
You know,
the Russians have plenty of video of me over the 5 years I spent in Moscow.
Do you know they have that video? You say it with such, I wouldn't, with just total confidence. Of course, that video of me naked.
Well, I mean, I would hope it's not that important to them, but.
But if it was, it would have been leaked a long time. Like, all this stuff you're saying they're accumulating with such ease just is happening.
Well, look, the Russians have a saying, Chem chelovek dishit, which in English means what makes a person breathe. And what they do essentially is they mount a full court press, collect as much intelligence information as they can on people, their private lives, whom they engage with, and they put it all together to try to understand the person as well as they can. They're doing that with every single one of the president's team who's out here. They're probably focused on you too, Sean. I don't know about me and Bongino. We're probably lesser targets for them, frankly. That'd be information overload.
They've already got me.
But that's what they do, and there's also an intense interest on their part in tracking how the president and his team and Kim Jong-un and his team react to that dinner you talked about and all the other engagement that they have over these coming days.
Do you think, especially in light of the president apparently developing, Dan Bongino, a pretty solid relationship with the president of China?
Yeah.
Do you think that it is maybe reassuring to them that the president keeps his word? I'm sure that they respect that he negotiates hard because that's what they do.
Well, the Chinese are in a delicate balance here. They don't want
their economy's taking a big hit.
Yeah, but they don't want a democracy aligned with the United States right across their border. But also, they don't want an unstable North Korean regime either. Remember, the North Koreans, 90% of their economy is China-based. I mean, they export minerals and coal to China. Without China, they're nothing. So there's kind of this delicate balance where you don't want instability. So those launches over Japan certainly weren't helping, but they don't want a U.S. ally, unified, denuclearized peninsula there either. So it's kind of an interesting dilemma they're in. But can I just say one thing? Dan's right, by the way, Sean. You asked him, how does he know that? When I was overseas with the Secret Service, we would rely on Dan's agency to give us all. These guys were phenomenal. I can't applaud what they do enough, and they do it quietly. Obviously, they can't.
But isn't that the danger of weaponizing, you know, our intelligence, like we've been talking about for now for 2 years?
Why do you think this whole Spygate thing interests me so much?
Yeah.
I understand that. But we would get an RSO briefing from the DSS guys who ran the embassy, or sometimes from his agency, depending on where we were, and they would bring actual pictures out, faces blanked out, and say, this is the CEO of a company in with a honeypot, and basically this is what this happens. And it's real. I mean, Dan's not making this up. This stuff is legit.
All right, take a quick break. We're in Vietnam in light of the summit that is forthcoming. All right, as we continue, Sean Hannity Show, we're in Vietnam. 800-941-SEAN is our toll-free telephone number. You want to be a part of the program. As we continue with Dan Hoffman and Dan Bongino. All right, so we got a lot happening here as the week unfolds. Predictions. Usually summits, Dan Bongino, are not predetermined, but you kind of have at least a baseline agreement going in, and then hopefully things get even better.
Well, supposedly from what I'm hearing, these lists of demands, give us your whatever, 20 top priorities from the North Koreans and vice versa, have already been exchanged. I've seen everything from, you know, putting North Koreans' ICBMs under control of the more, stable Chinese regime, to they're just going to get a statement out on what denuclearization actually means going forward. You never know. But Trump, you can't count Trump out, Sean. I mean, he has managed to do some incredible foreign policy breakthroughs. And I would even hate to render a guess. This could go really, really well, or, you know, it could be just okay. I mean, I that's the best you can say with him.
Dan Hoffman.
Yeah, a couple things that I would think are in the realm of the possible here. Establishing liaison offices where we would have an official presence in Pyongyang and the North Koreans one in Washington, that would certainly enable negotiations going forward. An agreement for inspectors to visit those sites I talked about. Maybe North Korea at least open to getting back into the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, from which they withdrew in 2003. But I think the big, bold move we might see is an official end of the Korean War. I think that might suit Kim Jong-un, and I think it might suit President Trump's policy as well, would dial down the level of intensity in this relationship a little bit in a positive direction. And I wouldn't be surprised if that issue comes to the fore.
All right. Last question. Will it be a full agreement? And what about the thing with China? What does that mean, the president's tweet today, that he's withholding more sanctions? Announcement forthcoming.
Well, it's huge news for our economy. I think it's a great idea. I think we have to do a lot with the Chinese on the agricultural front and get them to back down on intellectual property theft, also government procurement over there. But that's a huge breakthrough with the Chinese. I mean, you saw the stock market respond already and, you know, can only positively impact this summit as well. We need the Chinese to negotiate with the North Koreans.
Last word, Dan Hoffman.
Yeah, if there's just one among many things I learned at the CIA is just the extent to which this world is so interconnected, and there's a real confluence there between our economic negotiations with China and our strategic negotiations with North Korea, and I think the president is playing that extremely well right now.
All right, guys, thanks so much. Both will join us on Hannity tonight right here from Vietnam, and throughout the week we'll be checking in with them as things develop.